Okay, everybody, welcome again to our next lesson for our course, our next session together. And I hope that you are continuing to enjoy the journey. If you ever are coming to a place throughout the course where you're no longer enjoying it, then just talk to Mark or somebody. Either eat peanuts or talk to Mark and see if he has any ideas for sprucing up the course, and I'll put them in next time. In 8 years when I teach it again, all right?
It's been about that long, right?
Yeah, something like that. It's good. I'm enjoying it. And I hope you are too. Why don't we just open with prayer, and then we'll get right back into where we left off last time. Lord, thank you so much for this day that you have made. And Lord, I want to thank you today for who you are, and for the fact that you have a purpose and a plan for our lives, and that you desire to know us. Lord, I thank you that every person who is here, Lord, is here because of some sort of hunger or thirst that they have in their heart to know you more. And I pray that, Lord, you will, as you have for so many, you will satisfy that hunger and that thirst in a new way, and that you will show us a little bit more of the truth that is found in your word, and the truth about who you are, and what it is that you came to do, and what it is you are wanting to show us. And I pray that we'll have ears to hear and hearts to understand and to listen. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right. If you remember last time, we were taking a look at the nature of man in this sort of anthropological, I guess you could call it like a summary, you know, scratching the surface, really, of anthropology. And we looked at some things about man's constitution. We took a look at, how people are structured or made up, like the formation, whether we are made up of two parts, which would be called dichotomy, or three, body, soul, spirit, which would be trichotomy. Monism, which means that man is one entity, or conditional unity. We're essentially one, but there's a conditional unity there. It's compound, and it depends on what state we're in at the time, whether we are here on earth or whether we are awaiting the final resurrection, etc. And then the last thing we looked at was the factors that we can see from Scripture about the human spirit. As found, sometimes I have very specific scriptures listed there, and other times it's just there's a whole lot of scripture that can deal with something in very very specific ways, but there's so many of them, you know, that you can't necessarily include them all. But we saw that it's the center of personality, it's unique to us as mankind, that man men and women are the only creatures that God created to live forever, you know, to endure. With the spirit, to know him. It's through the spirit that we can know God. We talked a little bit about the fact that that's why your dog can't know God, but you can, all right, sort of thing. It's not just a consciousness issue, but it also is a creation issue. So God made us to know him, right? And so he made us that way. And that we're fashioned by God. It's what makes us different than animals. It allows us to know the things that God have a relationship with him. When our spirit's renewed and comes into this relationship with him, then we become really people who have the capability of worshiping God and having that outflow of our relationship. And to serve him, you know, with our lives and with, you know, the different things that we would say and we would do becomes acts of service to God. It is our spirit that's connecting with God. It's through our spirit, I also believe, that God speaks to us, and He convicts us, and he shows us his ways. You know, when God sort of speaks into your heart, that's your spirit, really, that's connecting with him in that way. And then, you know, we talked about a little bit when we had finished there about the connection between spirit and character, and that our character is formed as, you know, God makes us more like him. And that's sort of, I guess, a spirit and a soul thing, because our soul is that which wars against, you know, the struggle that we have in our mind and the battle that we have with our fleshly part of us, or the sinful nature. And we're going to get into that a little bit more today, looking at, sin and what that's all about, and, you know, what is the big deal about it, and how does that affect our natures. But before we get into there, let's take a look at some things that we can see from Scripture about the human soul. And again, this is not meant to specifically designate a differentiation between soul and spirit. That's not the purpose of this. But it is simply to report or to summarize some of the things that we see in Scripture, referring to the soul of mankind, the soul of people, all right? So sometimes Scripture will use the word spirit, and sometimes Scripture will use the word soul. And so all we're doing is pointing out those things that we find in Scripture that refer to these things. It's not meant to say, well, see, it specifically said soul here because it doesn't mean spirit. It's not meant for that purpose. We're not pointing that out for that purpose. But as we went through the things that we can see from Scripture about the human spirit, here are some things as well that we can see from Scripture about the human soul. First of all, that it is immediately and directly created by God at the moment of conception, although characteristics are inherited from parents. You know that you pick up characteristics from your parents. I mean, there are similarities in your DNA structure, and in your spiritual, soulish, whatever you want to call it, makeup as well. Your emotions, your mind, your will, your intellect. There are similarities there. But you are also a separate person. You are a distinct, unique person that God has made. And so, you can know for sure that although you inherited some characteristics from your parents, that you also have been immediately, and that means instantaneously. It's not like, it's not like God needs a lot of time, to form all the code for your body. He's just like, it's just there. And also, the word immediately also means fully, it's like, the word is like, it's a true creation word in that he took the very basic building blocks of life and made you out of it, and directly by God. And so even though, and you know what, that's an encouraging message for people, especially if they were born in difficult circumstances or in circumstances where they maybe were not wanted by the parents. One of the things that is really important to remember is that you're not an accident. That even if your characteristics and your birth circumstances and the reason that you were here in the first place had something to do with, the parents who did or didn't plan you, who did or didn't want you, who did or didn't have warm, fuzzy feelings in their heart when they found out that, you were going to be born. Besides all of that, God planned for you, and he created you, even if humans had a part to play, in the creation of you. That's an amazing thing to think about, that God uses. You can have all of the building blocks of physical life as we know it. So two people coming together to produce a child, but the reality is there's only one person who can cause a spirit and a soul to be animate inside a person's building blocks of life. There's only one, and that is God himself. So he planned it. He created you with that in mind. Another thing about the soul that we can see is that it's a principle of life. It animates the body. It's a sustaining thing of the body. And so the soul is really meant to be something that endures. When your body is getting old and heading towards, the grave, you can know that your soul, your spirit, will live on, and that it's a sustaining thing for the body. Sometimes we see people have this thing called a will to live, and they endure through some of the most unbelievable circumstances, and they hang on when you thought that they were going to keel over long ago. Whether that means through a sickness or a tragedy or a difficulty, or whether it means facing really, really horrendous circumstances in an accident or something that is life-threatening, this will to live is an incredible thing. Well, that's really found in that soul part of us. And I'm saying soul, not spirit, because remember, if you're not a believer yet, you might still have the will to live, so your soul is active and alive. But it's not like your spirit is the part of you that's doing that, because your spirit is only made alive when you come to Christ, right? So it's dormant. It's waiting to be resurrected. And we see also that it's not physical. It's immaterial. It permeates the whole body. There's not any part of you. You can't say, oh, my baby finger doesn't have my soul in it. It's like there's this animating, again, remember that anthropology is a study of metaphysics. So there's this metaphysical part of you that affects all of you. So it's not just that your brain happens to be this really incredible nervous, you know, center that is able to send, you know, little signals to the rest of your body, and somehow, you know, you wiggle your finger. And isn't that great? There's more to you than that, because there's a reason why you would think that thought in the first place. There are reasons and purposes beyond who you are that you would engage in certain thought processes to begin with, that then send command signals to the rest of your body. And it's not just learned behavior, it's purposeful behavior. So it's like, what are you going to use your hands for? Well, that's a like a spirit and a soul and a body thing all working together. And there is this sense that your whole body is meant to be a part of who you are, as much as the immaterial parts are part of who you are. And they sort of work very, very closely together. And the reason that you have the ability to think and to have a will and volition and all those things has everything to do with the way that God made you, you know, to have a soul and, of course, as a believer, a spirit that's alive and is fulfilling a relationship with Him. So we see, obviously, the soul, we all know this, it receives its impressions of the outer world in context of the other world through the body. If without a body, you know, you might be alive, like spiritually speaking, but you wouldn't be making any contact with anybody who is physically alive. It's through your body that you do that. You see, you touch, you feel, you hear, you speak. And it's like the senses that we know of, which are human, it's a bit of a mystery, because the body is often the vehicle through which we believe that all of our senses can even work at all, okay? So it's sort of like, you know, I see because I have eyes. So if I'm in my body, I need to have eyes in order to see. Sounds logical, right? I need to have a nose in order to smell, and ears in order to hear, etc. But the reality is that there is more to being able to exercise senses than just being restricted to a body. There are some amazing documented stories of people who have experienced things that you can't just limit to a human body. You know, maybe God showing them something, or them having some sort of experience that they're aware of, maybe that they're dying or they're gonna die or something. And it's like there's an ability to sense certain things that's beyond our body. And even the whole notion of, you know, the scriptures saying that when we pass from this life, we will, you know, when we stand before Jesus, what does it say? We will see Him. Well, you're gonna have eyes, you know? No, but that doesn't mean you can't see. You know what I mean? So there is an animate part of us. There is an alive, real, vibrant, thriving part of us that is not limited to our body, that is still alive after we perish here, that is with God. And there is every indication that our senses will be just as active there. And even before the resurrection, when we are reunited with new body. How many glad to get a new body? How many hoping to be taller? I noticed Rick didn't put his hand up. But the reality is, Rick's already like, yeah, I'm there, man. But the idea is, it's like we all have different, you know, reasons why we'd like a new body. Then it's like there's a completeness to us again. But there is every reason to believe that the abilities we have to engage senses and consciousness even a sense of presence, you know, with others, is not limited to physicality, right, or the physical properties of our body. So the soul is a mysterious thing, and it's sort of amazing, you know. The word soul can be used to refer to man's earthly life. So in some different scriptures, you see that, you know, the soul is specifically referring to the life that we have here and now. So again, I don't really know what that means for eternity or for the rest of, you know, eternity, but I do know, like I mean, you know, as soon as we die and are living beyond this life, I don't know what all that means for that, but I do know that it's used to specifically refer to the life that we're having here and now, you know, that soul that we possess. The soul, it's very important to note, can never be a part of God. It is never that part which is in fellowship and communion with God, because it can sin. And sin, as we know, can never, what? Have anything to do with God, right? And so it's like, God created us to be a perfect human being. He created us to have this, you know, inanimate part of us, to have a spirit that would know Him and that through which we can commune with Him. We lost that in the garden, which we're gonna get to the fall of man in a minute, but we lost something there, and then through Christ, the Holy Spirit resurrects our spirit, and we come back into fellowship with God, and we have this something that is alive again. But that war, that battle that exists inside us, which is the soul part of us, is that which really pulls us away from God or keeps us, you know? That sinful, fallen part of us is that which God, like, it's like God wants to have fellowship with us, but it's only through our spirit that He can do so, you know, in a way. And it's, I'm not trying to be so, you know, trichotomous that I say, well, here's your spirit over here, and here's your soul over here, and your body's floating somewhere in between. It's not like you're polarized, as much as it is that right within you, every part of you, you know, every part that you can describe, your soul, your spirit, your mind, your will, your body, every part that makes you a real person, there's a struggle going on. And that struggle can be described as the struggle of the soul or the struggle of the mind. You know, I have these thoughts that I know aren't pleasing to God, or I have these temptations that I, you know, to do something that's wrong. Well, guess what? There's a reason for that. It's because we have this thing called a soul or a mind or a will that is not, running towards God all the time. And so thank God that through our spirit, you know, He can pull us towards Himself, and we can speak to our mind and say, I will think about the things that please God. I will do the things that please God. I will not give in to temptation and win that battle over that. It generally distinguishes living things from non-living things, except for plants, obviously, which have life and some sort of element of instinctive behavior, but as far as we can tell, not a soul. And again, it's like one of those things where... would it be a stretch to say that animals have a soul? No, it's not a stretch at all. There is some sort of animate principle inside them, right? Your dog's alive. It knows something about being alive. It may not have a whole lot of self-consciousness, but it knows who you are, and it you know, hopefully likes you. And, you know, your dog, it knows where it is, for the most part, knows people, and they can learn things. They can learn behavior. They can learn patterns, and they can progress, you know, in their understanding. They can grow and mature just like anything does. But it's not a stretch to say that could be called a soul, in that it's an animate principle that is other than the physical DNA properties of the dog. So if you take all of the DNA sequence and all the things that are necessary to make a dog, you put it all together, you say, okay, come on, roll over, and the dog's just laying there. It's dead. It needs to be alive, okay? And there's something about the life of an animal that we say, well, I guess you could describe that as some sort of an animating principle, like a soul. But that doesn't mean, obviously, we have no evidence to suggest that, you know, that animals are, you know, forever creatures, you know, either. I don't know, maybe we will die and I'll find out that all dogs do go to heaven. I don't know. I'm not sure. Mark.
Well, I was just thinking, if you think about it, because I know people have said that they have house cats, born and raised and lived in the house, have never, you know, always been fed, always been pampered, whatever, get trapped outside, they still know how to hunt, they still know how to, they have all of their animal instincts, although none of those were ever trained or exercised, is the word I was looking for.
Yeah.
So that, in a way, I guess that could be kind of...
Yeah.
Speaking towards that.
That's amazing, isn't it?
What is that instinct, like human survival?
Yeah. You
know, if we got stuck in the woods, we might not know the best, but we would find a way to survive.
That's amazing. And, you know, people who don't believe in God at all and would say, well, that has nothing to do with any kind of creative intervention, would just call that, like a developmental thing or an adaptation. You know what I mean? But the reality is, although there is such a thing as adaptation, we don't want to deny that, there is adapting to surroundings and, you know, environment and stuff. Of course, we're not just talking about a creature adapting, because adaptation has nothing to do with what is inbred in the instinctive nature of an animal that has been only in a house.
And requires time.
Yeah, like if anything, they're not adapted. And so that speaks to, you know, instinct and nature, which is intelligently designed in that creature, right? And it's like, it's pointing back to the whole origins and the creation thing, but even more so, it's pointing to the fact that there is something, some sort of a consciousness inside that animal that knows what to do. And you ask, where did that come from? Well, I believe that God, as the creator, is the source of all, right? He's the source of all these things that we can see are amazing about life. And life is an amazing thing, you know? There's a lot of mystery to it. It's something we'll never truly figure out, but... And then we also see it is distinct from the souls of other living creatures, the human soul that is, as it lives beyond death due to the spirit. And again, I'm throwing that out as a theory or as a, you know, a proposition. I believe that the reason that we live on is because God created us to. And so regardless of the specific technical reasons why that is, and I'm not going to pretend to be a biologist or a scientist and say, well, I'll tell you why the human DNA makeup, you know, does this. Because no scientist in the world truly knows why we live on, except that we've been made to, all right? And it's like there is, and again, they don't know. If they don't believe that we do, then they would say that we don't. If they believe that we do, then we'd say they would do. But those who don't believe don't know why we wouldn't, and those who do don't know why we would, except that God made us that way, all right? And so it's like, well, at least we have a reason. You know, it's like if I say to a person who does not believe in life after death, well, why wouldn't we live after death? Well, I don't know, just because there is no such thing. Okay, so you don't know. And if they ask me, well, why would we? I would say, well, it's because, you know, of God. It's because He is my creator. He created me, and I know Him, and I have a relationship with Him, and I know that I'm going to see Him when I die. It's like there's this something inside of you, you know, that is assured of that. And I don't know how to describe it. It's really tough to describe, but it's like there, you know. Anyhow, sort of an amazing thing. But then we have the basis of, it is a basis of individuality and personality, like the spirit. So it's sort of a similar thing in that way to the whole spirit thing. Except, now think about this for a minute. Think about, this is just a proposition, but I wonder about it sometimes and see what you think about it. If your soul and your spirit, if there is a difference between the two, and I'm only saying that because there are scriptures that would suggest that it's your spirit that's made alive, okay, when you come to Christ. Not suggest, they actually say that, and that you still have a soul before that happens, okay? So let's just hypothesize with me. If the soul and the spirit are sort of, you know, different entities within you, and you, your soul is always alive, because that's the animating principle of you and your consciousness and your mind and your will, but your spirit is then made alive in Christ, and yet your soul is a basis of individuality and personality, and your spirit is as well. Now think about, just work with me on this. What if, when the soul is alive but the spirit isn't, your individuality and personality, although it's been created by God, can never be like Christ? Truly. Because there is something about you that is not alive yet that makes you like Christ. You know what I mean? And then when your spirit's made alive, then you have the potential to become more and more like Christ. And what does Galatians chapter 5 describe being like Christ as? Towards the end of the chapter.
The fruit of the Spirit.
The fruit of the Spirit, right? Galatians 5, like 22, 23 in there somewhere. It's like it describes the nature of Christ in us as the fruit of the Spirit. Well, if we have the fruit of the Spirit, truly the fruit of the Spirit, okay? The fruit is a byproduct of a healthy tree, right? You don't just go and say, well, I'm just going to go around and see if I can find some fruit lying on the ground, even though there's no fruit trees around. If you want fruit, you go to a fruit tree, because it's the tree that produces the byproduct of fruit. So if the fruit of the Spirit are in us, then that means the character, the nature, and the life of Christ Himself must be in us. And if that's the case, then we are His, we belong to Him, we have become alive in Christ, and our spirit's made alive, and then the individuality and personality that we have, that we always had, and were created with, now has the potential to be changed and refined and made more like Christ. So, like, it's an amazing thing to think. I mean, you know, I don't know what you think about this. Tell me what you think about this if you want. But it's like to think that if I am made by God, you know, but I don't know Him yet, and I have this individuality and this personality which is made by Him, and there's different reasons why we have different personality and character, right? Lots of different reasons: environmental, parental, you know, the way we're raised, all those things, circumstances, and choices we make, right? They all form us, our character. But then if my spirit is not alive, then the individuality and the personality that I have will never be able to truly become Christ-like and have the fruit of the Spirit unless the other part of me, which is the basis of individuality and personality, is made alive to allow my soul to come along for the ride, sort of thing. You know what I mean? Anybody have any thoughts about that?
I'm thinking of that. Yeah. Why sometimes when you talk about Satan, he takes your soul. I've never heard him say he can take your spirit. Mm. And is that because the spirit is alive and the soul isn't?
Well, I think we have to be really careful even with that sort of thought process, because it is it's a little bit of a cliche, if you want to call it that, you know, a phrase that was coined, Satan can, you know, take a person's soul. Jesus had different words to say about that, you know, and he said, fear not the one who can destroy the body. Now, that might refer to the enemy, it might refer to other people, right, to the mankind, because someone could shoot me right now and they could destroy my body. I could die physically. Then Jesus said, fear the one who can destroy both your body and your soul in hell. He's not talking about the devil. He's talking about God. His direct words were to the Father, who has the ability to destroy us completely if He wants. And what He's saying is we need to have a fear, and he's not talking about living in perpetual, you know, state of being afraid or fear as in, you know, that which paralyzes us. The word He's using there is a term of utmost reverence, like a fear of God that produces healthy living in us, you know, godly living, a fear of, sort of like fearing the king, you know what I mean? Like you say, fear the king, it's not like trembling, but the trembling part of it is, I want to do what's right, because if I don't, the king is going to have my head, that sort of thing. And again, we have to be really careful of that, because it's not like God's out to kill you, but the idea is that He is so awesome and amazing that He is to be revered in the highest sense of the word. And the word that we use often to describe that is to fear God, right? Jesus is specifically referring to the fact that God alone has the ability to, again, I'll coin that term, take your soul. You know what I mean? And so it's again, we don't even really know what that means, because that's sort of a term that we coined. But you are right. The Spirit's untouchable. And that part of what you said, absolutely. I would also propose, though, that nothing can touch us but that passes through God's hands, right? Remember what God said, remember we talked a few weeks ago about the story of Job, and how Satan was allowed to attack Job, and all the things he went through, and all that stuff. Remember what happened at the beginning of that story, where, you know, Satan went and stood before God, and he said, okay, have you taken a look at that, you know, that man, or actually, God brings up Job, and he says, look at, you know, how awesome, you know, how much he loves me, and how much he, you know, and Satan, you know, asks to have, you know, have his way with him, and to really mess him up, right? And God says, basically, you can only mess with his, you know, circumstances, and even his body, like, I mean, ravage his body, but you cannot touch his soul, basically, or his life, his spirit, whatever you want to call it, you know. So there was sort of an untouchableness there that had to go through the Father. Like, so it was like, that doesn't matter what Satan tried to do there. He would not be able to exceed God's limits. You know what I mean? So I think it's reassuring to know that we are in God's hands and nothing can happen to us except it passes through his hand. Yep, Joe?
There's a term, slaying of the spirit, that I'm not really I'm not really understanding of. So can you clarify that?
Sure, it's when you're in worship and God kills you on the spot. Anybody ever been slain in the spirit? What are you doing here? You should be dead by now. Wow, that's funny, eh, how we coin terms.
That's why I'm asking. Because
yeah, no, I don't blame you for asking. I know what it is only because I was raised knowing what it is. And unfortunately, we have these terms that sometimes are even endearing to us, but they don't really make a whole lot of sense, even to the believer's mind. okay, the word slain, or, you know, the word slay means to kill, right? It means to cut down, basically, all right? Or to, you know, lay out, knock down, lay out, right? And so, it's meant to be figurative, all right, obviously. And the idea is that you are in a place of worship, you know, and God touches you in some way, so that physically your body just kind of, you know, loses its ability to stand normally and to you know, be completely intact in every way. And so you respond by collapsing. You know what I mean? And I've seen it many times in a place where a person is filled with the Spirit or touched by the Spirit in some way. We saw particularly in the history of our Pentecostal church, some of those things happen in amazing ways. Pretty neat. I think that sometimes what happens, and I've seen this as a pastor who has not only been a pastor for a while, but as a person who grew up, you know, in that environment, I have seen that we tend to make theology out of experiences. And so we had different movements and churches and fellowships that would develop a theology based on the experience of what they saw happening, okay? So you would have a time around the altar or at the front of a church, a response time at the end of a service, and people would pray with other people, and those people would maybe fall down, all right? And it's like, that's kind of weird. And then if that happens more often, then we tend to develop a theology based on that experience that, oh, if God really touches you, then you'll fall down. You'll be slain in the spirit. And that's the term that we coined, okay? And what it basically meant is that God really has a hold of you now, so obviously you can't stand up anymore. And again, I don't want to dissect it or analyze it or overdo it in that, because I really do firmly believe in giving ourselves over wholeheartedly to God and allowing His Spirit to do in us whatever He wants. And if that means that I can't stand up anymore, then so be it, whatever. It's not as important that I have full control of myself as it is that God has control of me. So whatever that means, that's cool. All right, I'm cool with that. But at the same time, without overanalyzing it, we have to always be extremely careful that we don't ever form theologies that then maybe have terms associated or coining terms that are used that really don't make sense and shouldn't ever be theologies to start with. I don't think that these things ever happened so that we could incorporate them as theology. I think they were only ever meant to be some amazing, you know, and unique experience that some people would have without saying, well, let's bring it into part of our doctrine, and now as our fellowship of churches, we believe in that. Hold on a minute. You will never find, as part of Gateway Church, that we believe in that particular thing. Doesn't mean we're against it. Doesn't mean you can't experience it. Doesn't mean it's not, you know, amazing and wonderful if God touches you in a specific way, that you might have physical reactions that you didn't anticipate. But it's not part of theology. Theology is where we know from Scripture what we see is true, what we believe is real, what the Holy Spirit has inspired and is shown, and it is solidly based, you know, on Scripture. And there may be lots of different expressions of that, lots of different experiences that go along with that. That's sort of a little bit of the background, the history. But it's interesting that there was somewhat of a connection. It reminded you what we were talking about. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Sort of thing, you know. But yeah.
One thing that I've always, in my beliefs or my history or whatever you want to call it. But the soul is basically somebody that is living or in your being while you're here on earth. The spirit is always referred to as the afterlife, or,
right,
you know, whereas God is the spirit. you never heard of anybody referred, I haven't anyway, of anybody referred to God's soul.
Right. Yeah. I think it's because the only reference to soul in the scripture is only human. Yeah, only earthly and only human. I think there could be some very a lot of merit to what you just said, that in a sense it is your spirit which endures, okay? And it could be that your spirit is all of a sudden, you know, there, right? However, it is also very clear in Scripture that when you come to faith in Christ, your spirit right then is made alive. And so there is something that is born, and again, we're going to be getting into this study of salvation in a couple weeks, 2 or 3 weeks. And when we do that, we're going to look a little more pointedly at regeneration and, you know, what all that means. I'm not going to get into it now, but the idea is what you've alluded to is that there is something that happens that is a little bit of a mystery, because if it is after death, then none of us know, all right, really. I'm not even going to pretend to know. I believe by faith in what the Bible says is true, and that, you know, what the Holy Spirit, you know, has shown. But I also have never been there, so I haven't experienced it myself, okay? And so I believe that, yes, the Spirit lives on, but I also believe that what the Scripture says, that when you are still alive in this body and you come to faith in Christ, my spirit is made alive now. So there is something about me that is now alive and is going to stay alive forever. If I am not in Christ and my spirit never is made alive in Him, then at the moment of death, whether that means the soul is done and the spirit takes over, or whether that means I don't know. You know, I don't really know the answer to that, obviously, right? You know, so I've not been there. But that's a good point. Yep. And back there?
It's more back to the original question from up here. Gathered was, if the soul cannot be in fellowship with God, then something has to happen to the soul to enliven the spirit so you can have fellowship with God. And that's what there were two scriptures that were in my mind.
Yep.
One is, we have been predestined to be conformed to the image of Christ, which would say to me that God's original plan was that we would become like Christ. The second one is that Jesus came to seek and to save the lost, which would say to me that the first thing, that being conformed to the image of Christ, is only possible as Jesus seeks and saves that which is lost.
Mm, absolutely true. There is a bit of a mystery, obviously, when we're looking at soul and spirit and what those two things mean and what really is alive and what's not and all that. When we take what you just said with those scriptures, the first one, Romans 8, I believe, he's predestined us to be conformed to the image of his son. And secondly, that Jesus came to seek and save those who are lost. It's like something does need to happen to us, okay, in order to change our state of being. Would we all agree that a person, regardless of whether they know Jesus or not, is alive? And whether they're alive has nothing to do with whether they know Christ or not, right? Right? Now, you could say, only after I came to know Jesus did I truly begin to live, but that's a figure of speech. You were alive before, all right? Even if your spirit was dormant and waiting for resurrection, you know, from the Holy Spirit. The reality is, that person is still alive and conscious and understanding and has volition and will and consciousness just like you do, all right? And the reality is, it is something inside them which needs to change. A saving, a rescuing, a redemption, a regeneration by Christ, which is really Jesus coming to seek and save. The word save is a total, complete word, meaning to be completely redeemed and rescued in every sense of the word. Mind, soul, body, spirit, you name it, right? And it's like when you take that and then you say, but that was God's plan. That He predestined us for that. He predestined us to become like Christ and to know Him, to be conformed to His image. The reality is that if that's true, then it would suggest that people who don't know Christ do have this thing called soul, which is through what they can make decisions and have a mind and will and volition. But it is only as the Spirit is resurrected that you can be conformed to the image of His Son and be completely saved and changed and redeemed. So every part of you is redeemed. Again, I want to be really careful about that. It's not like, oh, my spirit's redeemed, but my body's just sort of over here doing whatever it wants to do, and my soul just kind of, you know what I mean? No, Jesus came to save you completely. He came to save every part of you so that your mind can be brought into submission to Christ, so that your body can be a temple of the Holy Spirit and can honor Christ. Otherwise, you could be like a Gnostic, who just like believes that the soul and the body are, and the mind and all that are completely separate from each other. And so one is good and one is evil, and that means you can, you know, have good intentions and think right thoughts and do all these things and then do whatever you want with your body to please it. You know what I mean? And some of the different ways that people had philosophies back in the years, ways that they used their philosophy to basically do whatever they want to do. No, Christ came to save you completely. He came to save your body, your soul, your spirit, everything. He wants to bring all of those under his submission to him so that he can become alive in you in every sense of the word. You know what I mean? So there is a redemption that he wants to work in us. Better move on. All right. We see that it has certain instincts, the soul that is, self-preservation, achievement, reproduction, nourishment, dominance. All those things are true, all right, about the instincts that we have. We want to live, we want to achieve, we reproduce, we want to be fed, we want to control, all right? And again, that desire to control doesn't mean necessarily extreme. It just means to be in control of our circumstances around us, all right? To express those things. Humans have a conscience, which is interrelated with the soul and spirit. It is described in different scriptures. There's one in particular, I believe it is from, it's either the First Timothy or it is, I got to think about which one. It might be the Corinthians one. A law written on their hearts. I want to encourage you to check out all those scriptures that are supporting these points that we looked at. But particularly this phrase, law written on their hearts, that's an amazing thing to think about, you know? That it was like God said, you know, when I first gave the law, it was external. It was completely separate from you. I gave you the law, you got to obey it or you're going to die, all right? Pretty clear cut. And then in the New Testament, after Christ came and the Holy Spirit was sent to indwell us and to bring us to Christ, there is this law written on our hearts. And it is this sense of conscience that is even greater than the sense of conscience that was in the Old Testament that every human being still had. Every human being has the capacity to sense what is right and wrong. Some people's sense are really messed up, okay? If one person thinks it's absolutely perfectly okay to steal, they're wrong, all right? If they think it's okay to injure or hurt another human being, they're morally wrong. There's a bankruptcy morally inside of them. But we also know that their conscience has been messed up and marred and mangled and seared, all right? There's something that has happened to it. But when you come to Christ, there is something that happens to our conscience. It's like something is renewed in that conscience. You are awakened to things that you didn't know were wrong before or didn't really have a sense that were wrong. And all of a sudden, oh, what's with this, you know? We have had people who, for example, without us saying anything, without us preaching anything, have come to Christ and become believers in Christ and then have come to us and asked us, should I stop doing this? This is probably wrong, right? And it could be anything. I mean, it might be anything. It might be sexual. It might be, you know, a life involvement. It might be something that's ethical, you know, as far as, you know, like, for example, cheating on your taxes or ripping, you know, somebody off, like taking something from work. You know, if nobody knows and nobody really, you know, cares and nobody really notices, is it really wrong? You know what I mean? It's questions like that of ethics and of morality. And it's funny, eh? How all of a sudden something is awakened in them that's a renewed sensitivity in their conscience that says, this is wrong. I probably shouldn't be doing this. Now, I also believe that that's probably the Holy Spirit who is convicting them of that. But I also know that there is something that happens inside of us that the Holy Spirit desires to change and renew and make us more like Him. And we suddenly become awakened and conscious of things that we weren't conscious of before, you know? Sort of a mystery, but, you know, amazing thing. Yep.
So how is it as believers, and especially as new believers, I mean, it's kind of a self-answering question, but how is it we can learn so well to tune out the Holy Spirit and ignore what he is saying to us.
We're pretty good at that. Wow.
Because I can think about it. I mean, if you look at the scriptures, the only unforgivable offense is grieving the Holy Spirit. I'm like, I am screwed. I'm sorry. Yeah.
Not grieving. Blaspheming.
Blaspheming.
And there's a difference.
Okay.
Yeah, we grieve the Spirit all the time.
Yes.
Yeah. Me included. Paul actually encourages us in one scripture, don't grieve the Holy Spirit, there's a lot more things he says in that passage that are related to that, which I won't go into, but the idea is that that's something we are all capable of on a regular basis. Blaspheming the Holy Spirit is a completely different thing. That's like a complete life that is, in a sense, there's another word that's used for it, it's apostate or completely forsaken the faith and the gospel. And it's like given over to absolute, self and evil, really. It's like away from the gospel, hardened against God, and will never come to repentance, ever, under any circumstances. That's a state of being that Jesus warns is unforgivable. It means you will never come to Christ. You will never, ever come back. You just won't, right? There's another scripture in Peter where it's really mysterious, but he talks about those who have actually come and partaken of Christ, and then they fall away, will not come back to repentance. And again, it doesn't mean a person can't repent, but he's talking about a very specific state that a person is in who does not truly belong to Christ, but they have been hardened by what has happened, and that hardening has caused them to fall away for good. We don't know who that is. That's the thing. That's the, you can't go, oh, look at Jim over there. He's obviously apostate. I can tell that Jim has blasphemed the Holy Spirit. You know what I mean? He has completely fallen away. There's no hope for him. Write Jim off. All right? We don't know. We can't tell. But here's what we say about it. If you're concerned that you may have done that, you haven't. It's the last thing you will be concerned about. Okay? So if you have completely shut the door on God in your life, you'll never think about it again, ever. And no one will ever be able to get you to think about it again. So I'm only addressing that, Mark, not just to correct the way you're thinking about it, but more to bring clarity to the notion that when we do that with the Holy Spirit, and then we repent of that, it's like I ignore what he says to me. I do my own thing anyhow. Like you said, I'm pretty good at shutting out his voice and not listening to him. I'm like, why? What's wrong with me? Why don't I do? Well, that's that war, right? Of the soul and the spirit and the mind and all that stuff. And then, what's going on? And we're struggling to bring that part of us that rebels against God back into line so that it will, submit to God as much as it needs to, right?
So there's still a chance to do it, but once you've renounced...
Well, we're not talking about a one-time occurrence.
Yeah.
We're not ever talking about, look at that, I blasphemed the Holy Spirit yesterday. Oh, today's going to be a rough day. It's not like a one-time occurrence. It's a life. It's like a series of things that a person does and the choices that they make in order to completely turn their back on God for good. And again, we can't point out anybody. We can't go, well, it looks like so-and-so. Like, we don't know, right? We can speculate, but we're never going to know for sure until eternity. The other thing, too, is that sometimes when you think a person is far gone, you think they can never be saved. It's pretty much right then that they come to faith in Christ, isn't it? You know what I mean? It's like, wow, okay, if God can save that person, if God can save Jeff, he can save anybody, you know what I mean? And it's like, Jeff will go, yep, I'm there. But the reality is we never know, right, who can come to Christ. We just never know.
I don't know how he knew, that
example.
That's our judgmental state, though, saying that that person is unsavable.
Well, then we tend to think that we can make some of those calls. And the reality is we can't. Only God can do that. So let's look at the fall, all right? And we're not talking about, you know, as opposed to spring, summer, and winter. We're talking about a very specific time in which mankind fell from God's favor, you know, fell from relationship with God, and fell from communion and fellowship with God and intimacy with God, and we call that event the fall, right? And so it was a pretty long fall in many ways. It's really hard for us to understand the kind of relationship that Adam and Eve had with God. It's not easy for us to truly understand the kind of you know, communion and fellowship and conversation and relationship and depth of, you know, connection that they had with God. There's a mystery there that we will probably never truly understand. I had someone come up to me probably last week or the week before and say, you know what, like, was it, like, what do you think it was like in the garden when they, like, when it says God walked with them and talked with them? It's like, he doesn't have a body, but like, what, you know, what is that? And it's like, it's, I don't know. It's not an easy thing to, you know, to even figure out remotely or to try and put your hand, you know, get a handle on, or to even imagine, because we have never, you can have a relationship with God through Jesus Christ by faith in Him and know Him personally and get to know Him more and more throughout your entire life, but it will always be different, always, until we see Him. It will always be different than what it was with Adam and Eve. And we just don't know exactly what all those differences are, but we know that it's different. Yeah.
Well, they could be in His presence and not be destroyed because they did not have sin in them.
No, sin at all, yeah.
So, that's an example. It's like that was before they fell, yeah. They were right with God, fully and utterly right with God.
Yeah. That's a good point, Mark, because remember, it is only through the blood of Christ that we can have standing before God, right? Apart from that, we have no hope. We're dead, okay? So before that happened, they have absolute, like, undeterred fellowship with God, face to face, whatever that meant, right? We don't even know what kind of state, you know, physically they would have been in. We know that the gene pool is pretty rich, all right? Like 100%, you know, brain capacity would be full, no inhibition, like no, nothing that is darkening the mind. You know, the scriptures say that sin darkens the understanding and it separates us from the life of God, and that it brings a blindness and a delusion, all right, a mist sort of, all right. And so we know that there's so much of our brain capacity that's not tapped, all right. Is that because we haven't evolved into those creatures yet that will use 100% capacity of our brain? Or is that because, as the scripture says, sin has darkened our understanding so that we cannot truly ever utilize that? All right? That doesn't mean you get saved and all of a sudden you're smarter. Only if that were true, eh? I wish. Huh? I wish, you know. But the reality is, what it does mean is that if you look at the example of Adam and Eve, then you have every reason to believe that what they experienced was complete, total perfection as human beings in every sense of the word. So not only are they powerful beings who are the perfect human specimen, but are there is no pain in their joints. Their muscles don't suffer from, you know, all the stuff that our muscles from. It's like there is no deficiencies, there's no weaknesses, there's no propensity to do their own thing, there is no desire to sin, there is no desire to do anything wrong, there is no such thing as wrong, and there is no limitations. I mean, we don't even know what their capabilities would have been. We don't even know what, like, if they have fellowship with God, is that because there was something about even their state and their nature of their minds and their spirits that were so far beyond our imagination? You know what I mean? I mean, we know that angels are powerful creatures who have this incredible ability to not only be in the throne room of God, but be invisible to our eyes and pass as fast as light through the universe. And it says, you made mankind a little lower than the angels. Well, when I look in the mirror, the first thing I think of is it's a lot lower ages, okay? So something has happened there to change me from Adam to Tim. It's a long way down, okay? So, I mean, think about this. Adam named all the animals, came up with the names. You know what I mean? Like, hello, this guy is a smart guy, okay? Name them all, remember them all. I'd have to change the name every time. What were you? I don't know, we'll call you a dog. What was it last time? I don't remember. Eve, do you remember? No, I don't remember. Yeah, it's like, you know what I mean? Kyla, what were we going to ask? Oh, sorry. I went on until you forgot, right?
No, what I was going to say was, if they had no sin, then why did Eve eat the apple?
Why did she?
How could she have been persuaded?
I would like to know why the woman.
We all know why that was.
Ate the apple first. I would like to know. all right. You know what? Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to get you to hang on to that. And I don't want you to forget it. And we're going to go through the fall, just briefly, it won't take long. And then let's look at that, all right?
Okay.
Because I think it might partly be there, all right? And make sure, though, if it's not, like, you know, addressed enough, let's do that.
Okay.
We see before the fall that man was a spiritual being and had a body. We see that man had 5 instincts or senses. We see that man was not sinful, but sinless. That's hard to even imagine, right? Wouldn't that be nice? We see, fourthly, man was given the capacity for great knowledge. That man's physical, spiritual, and moral condition was described as very good by God. Now, think about who God is. God, limitless, sovereign, omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent, immutable, that means unchanging, being, creator of all there is, says, it's very good.
He's well pleased.
There's no junk in there, right? Like, this is... One person said it this way, and I love this description. God made a lot of things, but you are his crowning achievement. Isn't that amazing? He's the only thing you're the only thing, rather, that he said, this isn't just good. Michael, Gabriel, guys, check this out. This is very good. And they're all like, yeah, very good. How did you do that? You know, seriously, it's like, wow. Right? Think about the complexity of who you are and what God has made you into. Now multiply that, like, by a million times, or who knows what, and we see how God intended us to be. Made Adam and Eve absolutely perfect, phenomenal creations, okay? But we see that if they're described as very good compared to the rest of the creation, then there is something there about us that must be unique, must be different, must be special, must be set apart, as it were, okay? And that brings us to the last one, that God gave man free will and the ability to make choices.
Okay. Just going back, this kind of struck me as, you know how evolution teaches us that we came from sort of crap, become what we are now, and we only aspire to get that we are getting better,
yeah.
And yet the Bible says we came from the best,
mm-hmm.
And are sort of
turning to crap.
Right?
Yeah. How many are you feeling encouraged right now? How many of you are leaning towards evolution? I'm getting better all the time, not crappier.
I
suit you.
You know, like it's like it's so inverse.
It is inverse. Yeah, you're right.
It sounds useful.
And the other thing too about what you just mentioned is. It's like the stuff that we're actually made of is not as important when it comes to considering God's true creative work in us as the character and the nature that he is producing in us. So, all right, look at evolution. Evolution refers to only the physical. We came from crap, but that's not metaphysical. there's nothing about evolution that teaches that you've got an amazing spirit now. No, there is no spirit. You are just somehow some creature who's conscious of yourself and is able to make decisions and have a sense of purpose, even though there's no explanation for that. You came out of, you know, a cesspool, or life went formed somehow, and now what? You're. But all that's saying is that your physical properties have become more complex, which again is sort of, doesn't make sense. But what you mentioned, Jody, was that that we are, if we're progressing from what was amazing, all right, to what is not, that's more of a spiritual thing. Spiritual condition. We're not becoming crappier physically all the time. You know, like, in other words, what we are physically is not any different than what it was thousands and thousands of years ago as far as just humanness or what makes a human a human or what makes a human complete. We have more sicknesses and more diseases and more, you know, things that are problems and issues now than we ever have before, mostly because of choices and because of things in our environment and stuff we've allowed. But that's a different thing than the progression from perfection to that which is in, you know, great need, you know, of God's salvation. Remember this, as soon as Adam and Eve sinned, they were in desperate need of God's salvation, just like you and I are. Yeah?
You have to take that into consideration too with being a child. When you're born sinless, you were born pure, you were born flawless in some states. Whereas the Adam and Eve story is almost the same thing, where they were perfect and pure. And I don't know your name.
Jeff.
But as Jeff was saying, going downhill, it's almost like from the time that we steal in the cookie jar, or put our hand in the cookie jar and steal that one cookie, it seems that we're, you know, it is our conscious choices that we make.
Yep.
That
we do. And here's the mystery of what you mentioned. Is that there are two reasons why we worsen, if you want to call it that, okay? One is that we did make the choice at some point to put the hand in the cookie jar, okay? So that is something I personally own. I'm responsible for that. If I put the hand in the cookie jar, I could have chosen not to, but I chose to, okay? But then there's a second part of it, which actually I will take what you said and just make one exception to it. Pure, innocent, yes. Sinless, no. And that's the difference, is that when we're born, we are already sinful. Not because we sinned yet. That's the first time you put the hand in the cookie jar. You have taken that step towards wrong, evil, call it what you want. But even before that happens, you have a propensity towards the cookie jar, even before you know what cookies are. But the idea is you have this nature inside you that has the propensity to do your own thing, right? And that's even before the choice to sin. So that's the duality thing fighting, you know, which we'll talk about very, very soon about this nature that's in us that's under the nature of sin, all right? But no, good point. So where were we? Capacity for great knowledge. Okay, God gave man free will and the ability to make choices. Then came this thing called the fall. All right, let's make some notes about this. We've got some scriptures, not a lot, but I encourage you to look them up. Man's fall came after the fall of Lucifer from heaven. All right, after. If you want to specifically research the fall of Lucifer from heaven, it's found in two different scriptures. One is in Isaiah, and the other is in Ezekiel. And it's basically that, you know, without going too much into it, that Satan was not always Satan. That's a different name that was given to him after the fall. He was created as Lucifer, which means star of the morning. And every indication would be that he was the most powerful and the highest angel in all of heaven. There's one description in one of those scriptures one of the books that I mentioned, that it actually makes reference to the fact that that right within him, in his being, in his entity, was the capacity or the ability to, in a musical way, worship God with his being. So whether that means that there were some sort of musical instruments actually fashioned in his celestial body, I don't know. But there's every indication to believe that he was probably the worship angel. Probably the one who was in charge of worship. All right, we have Gabriel, who is the head of, you know, what we call, you know, the archangels, like the one who is the greatest messenger. Gabriel's the one sent to tell, you know, Mary, you're going to have a son, and by the way, it's God. Okay, and you know, so that's pretty important, kind of important mission. You know, Gabriel's the one sent to, you know, speak to Joseph about how he's going to have a son. And, like, there's different times when a person, when an angel like Gabriel is used. Michael has a very specific role as an archangel of the head of the Lord's armies and hosts. He is a warring angel, all right? And it is he who's described in Daniel as warring against, you know, the dragon, against the serpent, against the devil, you know, and his angels. And there's one thing missing from that trio, and it is the angel who is in charge of all the worship of heaven. And so there's obviously a vacancy in that department. Now, I had one friend a number of years ago who wrote an incredible 25 or 30 minute show that was done with lighting and sound and all that stuff, and I actually scored and wrote all the music for it. It was called Journey into the Fourth Dimension, and what it was a story that was written that was based on some scriptures that I've mentioned and others that were sort of speculation. You know, it's like, I wonder if this might have been the case. And what that story was that what if Lucifer was created as the highest angel in all the worship of heaven, in charge of all the worship in heaven, and after the fall, that was left vacant. So God created man to worship him, to fill in the gap. You know what I mean? And now it's like God used to blow with his wind and his breath and his spirit on Lucifer, and he would worship with all the hosts of heaven. And when that stopped, now God blows upon us with his breath and his spirit, breathes into us the breath of life, and fills us with his spirit and blows into our lives with his spirit, and now we worship him. And we lead all of mankind to worship him, where Satan failed at that. You know what I mean? That's just a neat, you know, sort of picture. Yeah.
Well, is it safe to say then that that we were actually created after Lucifer's fall as well?
Yes. Absolutely. Yeah. We know that, well, you know what? Safe to say, yeah. Certain? Probably. Like, only because the only recorded history that we have in Scripture just says that man, or God did this, right? He created everything that there was, and then after man's creation, the devil appeared as a creature called a serpent, which we don't know what that looked like. We know that prior to God cursing it, it did not crawl on the ground. Because the curse of God was that it would crawl on the ground. In other words, figuratively speaking, he's speaking of a snake, right? And Satan is called a snake, figuratively, throughout Scripture after that. Isn't that amazing? You know, even a dragon. You know, again, we don't even know what that means. It's figurative. But the point is, he embodies some sort of creature and comes to deceive them, right? We'll get into the fall, what that meant. But we don't know, we're not sure of the timeline in between there. We don't even know how long that would have been. You know what I mean? So, here's another thing. When it says that Adam lived 930 years and died, was that after being created or after sinning? Can you count his age after he was created or not? Because he wouldn't age. He wouldn't age at all, right? There's only one thing that makes you age. It's that you are a sinful human creature If you are created to live forever, you won't die. You won't age. What did God say to them after they sinned? Now you will die. And they started the clock ticking towards death. They would never have died. So they would never age. They'd live forever, perpetually in a perfect age. Now, here's a little tidbit. I just thought of this now, okay? So I'm going to give it to you because I'm thinking about it, okay? They have done some studies in the last probably 30 years in science, and in, specifically in biology, in which they have tried to describe what happens in the human body as we are born as little children and we progress and seem to grow and expand and multiply, and the cells just go, 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 and then at some point it goes, no, 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 right? Until we die, okay? And it's like, what's going on? How come my cells are dying inside of me and I can't remember that anymore? I used to be able to remember that. What's going on? I didn't smoke drugs. My brain cells are going, boom, boom, boom. They're popping out of my head as I'm sitting here, okay? And we can't figure out why we're progressing and growing and getting better and better at this and everything's awesome, and then I'm done, all right? Crash and burn, all right? Sorry to discourage any of you who are over a certain age, but I'm not meaning to do that. But the point is, why? Why? Why is it at this peak of the mountain, wherever that is, we do a 180? How many of you remember the 180? Okay. Some of you haven't put it in your hands because you haven't reached it yet. You'll know what I'm talking about, okay? It's like everything starts to break down, right? So it's like we move from regeneration, right, to maintenance. Right? You're not getting better. We might be getting better, you know. We don't get older, we get better, right? That's just malarkey, okay? We get older. And it's like something about us starts to break down. Why? It's just because we age. It's just because... No, there's actually a turning point. And the point at which we turn, they found, and I'm speaking of physiological discoveries in science and biology, that this point at which we turn is almost universal in humans. And guess what age that is?
I don't want to know. 21?
25?
Nope.
32.
What?
33.
Think about that. What would Jesus have done had he continued to live?
Would have been downhill.
Would he have aged? How could he age? Sin breaks you down. Sin causes disease. Sin causes sickness. Sin causes everything that ails the body. Would it be possible for Jesus to get sick? He is the healer. He possesses virtue and healing in his body. He couldn't get sick. He couldn't die. He could not age. So imagine, Jesus is 90, walking around Palestine. People are like, how old are you? You look good. Okay?
Very good.
Very good. Okay? The point is, and this is the point, when you extrapolate that, I mean, this is a secular scientific discovery that they discovered this thing they call the age of perfection. It is where the body stops regenerating itself and changes the way that it exercises its ability. Again, I'm not a scientist. I'm not even going to pretend that I came up with any of this. I mean, obviously, I didn't come up with it, but I mean to really understand it. I'm just reiterating these things that I read and you know, discovered, and it was like, wow. They call the age of perfection because at that point, you will never develop anymore. You will never become more than what you were, okay? At that point, you will never add cellular-wise to the to improving or adding to what you were, all right, born with. And then at that point, something switches, and you begin what some people call the downhill thing, okay? That is, you're just continuing to try and make the best and maintain and maintain and maintain until you cannot anymore, okay? And the point of all that is that when Jesus gave himself as the ultimate sacrifice for our sin, remember in the Old Testament what would only be acceptable to God was a lamb that was what? Perfect, without spot or any kind of blemish, or any kind of weakness. Jesus was the perfect lamb, not just spiritually, but physically. In every way, he was ready. And it was the time for him to say, now. Because physically, he would have begun to, like, there would be such a marked difference between him and other people, really, right? So, okay.
Okay, so what confuses me about that, and I know it's kind of not theory, but it's when he would fast, he didn't need food. So was he teaching the concept of fasting? Like the 40 days in the desert, he didn't eat and he would fast before prayer. So it was not lip service, I don't know how
I know what you mean. Yeah, it wasn't just for illustrative purposes. Jesus would need food in order to thrive.
But then
okay,
he could
physically speaking, well, the question is, could he die?
Right.
Yeah, he could die. He could die. But his death would have to be willingly.
But then that speaks of degradation and the possibility of degradation.
But he died on a cross, right? Through, you could say, loss of blood or whatever, but the reality is he gave up his spirit, right? He gave up his life. He has said, no one can take my life from me. He said, the Son of Man has the power to lay his life down. He has the power to take it up again. And so, no matter what, if Jesus reached this point of absolute starvation, let's say, would he die of starvation? Only if he said, I'm going to die now. It's like there is absolute power over death and over life, okay? So if that's the case, then it's really difficult to even understand the illustration. But we do know this. After 40 days, he'd be just as hungry as you and I would be, which is the basis for the temptation. The reason he is equally as tempted is because he's equally as hungry, equally dying for food, starving for food, needing food, right? Feeling the sense of must have food, same as you and I. Okay, so at every point it says he was tempted like we were, but he didn't sin. He didn't give into it. So again, what would happen when Jesus died? Those are really hypothetical, and it's impossible to answer them. They're like a never-ending circle, right? You know, sort of thing. We better move on, okay? So man's fall came after the fall of Lucifer from heaven. Man's fall was in response to Satan as a tempter, not an enforcer. The devil made me do it, never cuts it in God's eyes. He provided an attractive alternative or a choice. All right? And if you want to revisit that story, I encourage you to do that in Genesis chapter 2, all right, in chapter 3. We see, you know, God's creation and then the fall happening right after that. We don't know how soon after, but we see it happening there. It's very important, number three, to note that man exercised free will to choose the alternative. He exercised free will to choose the alternative. We cannot say, well, I didn't really see it coming. I was sort of blindsided. How can I help it? You know, like people do when they stand in court sometimes and they try to explain to the judge why they were so stupid, all right? Well, they try to make up all these excuses, but the reality is they were really dumb. They did something really stupid. They did something they shouldn't have done. They made a wrong, bad choice that was the alternative to what they should have done. And the only thing they should ever say is, yeah, I did something really dumb. I made the wrong choice. But what do? The fact that we don't say that and don't do that is another testimony of the fact that we are sinful. All over again. It's like every time I want to defend myself, every time I want to stand up for myself, oh, it wasn't really that bad, there was all these circumstances. No, no, no. I am now defending and justifying my own sin, my own bad choices, my own responsibility. I am once again trying to get rid of my responsibility, say it wasn't my fault. I am proving once again that I am utterly, completely sinful and in total need of God's redemption. Like in every sense of the word that you can be. Every time I justify my sin, I am proving that I'm sinful. Every time I try to make up an excuse, I am proving that I'm sinful. Every time I try to say it wasn't really my fault, it was somebody else's fault, I am proving that I'm sinful. Because I am not coming clean and taking the high road, and there's only one thing we can do is say, I made the choice. I chose the alternative. There are many reasons why I may have, and they may not all be my fault. I understand that. But I must take responsibility for what I did. And Adam and Eve, at that point, had to take full responsibility. And of course, God made them take responsibility for what they did. Man committed, number four, a direct act against God, which is called sin. Not just a human mistake, not a psychological defect, and not an act of ignorance. Did they know what they were getting into? Not totally. Because there's probably no way they could have truly foreseen all the consequences. In that way, Satan was telling them the truth. Right? What did Satan tell them? If you eat this fruit, you will be like God, knowing what? Good from evil. Right? So it's like, you will know the difference. They didn't know the difference before. So were their eyes opened, in a sense? Did they gain understanding? Yeah, in a sense, but only through experience. What a horrible price to pay to learn something. Are we any different? How many of you have found that we all tend to learn the hard way? Right? So it's, we're all just like, you know, I've heard people say, oh, if they hadn't been so stupid, you know, we wouldn't be this, no, we're just as stupid. You'd have done it too. So would have I, okay? Come on now, all right? Only it probably wouldn't have taken us so long. You know what I mean? So, seriously, it's, you know what I mean? Yeah. So, it is sin. It's important that we call it that, all right? Man's sin was pride, doubt, unbelief, and selfishness. All wrapped up into one act. We believe what the enemy said. It said, yeah, we can be like God. The scriptures that I mentioned to you in the Old Testament before, from Isaiah and from Ezekiel, where it says that Lucifer fell from heaven, it says in the one scripture that he said, I will ascend to the Most High. I will become like him. I will be as high as God, as important, as great as him. That's pride. What did we say? Same thing. The enemy said to Eve and Adam, you will be like God. And we went, cool. I can be like God. I am important. Pride, right? Doubt. Did God really say that to you? Oh, come on. He didn't really mean that. Well, I guess he didn't really mean that. You're doubting that what the Word of God said was true. If God said you will die, and the enemy said, no, you're not going to really die, then you have to doubt God's Word to be true in order to believe what the enemy's going to tell you, right? Unbelief. They had to choose to not believe, and then, of course, selfishness. It says that Eve looked at the fruit and went, that looks yummy. It looks like it would be really good to eat. Selfishness. I want that. And we are still coveting stuff to this day, are we not? I want the big screen television. Right, Jim? We're there, man. Okay. I have no idea if you have a big screen television. I'm just saying, you know, two, that's great. I hit a nerve. That's awesome. Wow, did I pick the right one? Thank you, Lord, for leading me. No, I'm kidding, because I have one too, okay? The reality is we still covet stuff to this day, things that are we like, okay? And so, you know, it's passed on. Number six, through man's fall, sin entered the world. And this is a very important point where you understand the rest of our human nature correctly. Man's nature became sinful. So, Kyla, to go back to what you said. We have Adam and Eve, they're perfect. There is no such thing as sin in the world. God puts this one tree in the middle of a garden that has thousands and thousands of every possible fruit and vegetable you could ever imagine. Every possible piece of food, okay? You name it. You want to talk about gardens. We always get this idea that it's just fruit trees. Can I have something other than fruit, please? Okay, not like that at all. Every possible amazing garden that is lush with everything. You know, you want to talk about making good salad. They could make salad, like, out the wazoo every day, okay? Every kind of food you can imagine, okay? And we have these perfect human creatures who God places in the garden, and he has this one tree that is meant to give them the power. Remember, that tree being there gives them the power to love God voluntarily. That tree is an empowering thing for them to say, God said this is a no, and everything else is a yes. Therefore, I will choose to love God voluntarily and want to know him, because I will say no to what he says no to. That's the only way that God could have possibly created us to have true free will, is if we have the ability to say, and the opportunity to say no to that which he says no to. If we didn't have the choice, how could we possibly say no to what God says no to and truly say yes to him? Right? Could we? If there's no alternative, then what would we choose? Only him. Would it be voluntary? There would be no voluntary. There is nothing else. You know what I mean? If you don't have another choice, then there is, the discussion's over. But if you have a choice, God wants to give you that choice so you can choose him. Isn't that amazing? I mean, that's like, complex human nature stuff. But it is God's reason for allowing us to have that choice. So we have that tree in the garden. Lucifer, in the form of some sort of creature called a serpent, which we have no idea what it looked like or what it, physically, what characteristics it had, but he spoke through it and he said, "Hey, what are you doing?" You know, and however he sounded, I don't know. But it was like he spoke to the woman and said, he questioned God's word. He said, "You're not going to really die," made her doubt it. But remember this, it says that Adam was with her. Okay? I would really like to blame her in this. I really would. Any guys with me? But I can't. Some would actually go as far as to say this, that the woman was deceived by the serpent, but the responsibility rested on Adam because he made the conscious moral choice to do what his wife was deceived. It doesn't mean she's inferior to him, doesn't mean she was stupid or anything like that, but the responsibility rested on him, because not only was he created first, he was called by God to be that spiritual head, that spiritual leader, and he failed because he made the moral choice to do that which the serpent was trying to deceive his wife. He could have stepped in and said, "Get lost," and he didn't. He messed up. And ever since then, we've been struggling with the role of leadership and the role of influence and the role of moral responsibility that we have. Have we not, guys? It's true. We all share that, you know, with Adam. Jim?
I was just thinking, God gave Adam the responsibility to name all the animals. And Satan appears as a creature.
Yeah.
Adam wouldn't have named them. So.
That's interesting.
Why wouldn't they recognize something wasn't right?
Yeah, I mean, even the serpent, you know, it says the serpent was more crafty than any other beast of the field. So we are probably talking about some sort of creature that did have an identity already and some sort of name. It was called a serpent, right? So I would tend to think probably, Jim, that it was like the devil embodied it or something. I don't know. Like, that's a mystery.
Took on the form of it,
yeah. I don't know. It's weird. I wish I knew, but I don't know that one. So then we have the nature of sin, which we're left with. Okay, let's try to get through this as quick as we can so we can move into the next part. We have the nature of sin, and that is that man is by nature sinful. Romans 3:23 says that. That sin and sinfulness is universal. Everyone has the tendency to sin. There's not a one person on the planet that says, yeah, I'm different than all of you. I'm exempt from that. I really don't have that nature, okay? I only do what is good and right and honest and true and everything. I never think about myself. No such thing, okay? All 7 billion of us have the tendency to sin. Sin is not just a human weakness or deficiency. It is a state or a condition of man in relation to God. Remember, now, again, make a statement here. You can do with it what you want. You can think about it. You can tuck it away. You can say whatever or whatever. That's cool. Remember, if you take God out of the picture, you cannot say there's even such a thing as sin. You can't. Because God's the one who said it was sin in the first place. So, let's take it even a step further. If you take God out of the picture, can you really say murder's wrong? Really? If there is no God, then what right do you have to tell me that I can't kill somebody? Just because you're a human and I'm a human and you think that all of society has decided that it's wrong to kill people, what do you mean wrong? What if what I think is wrong and what you think is wrong is different and I think it's okay to kill people? Unless there is something outside of both of us that has had the authority, and I don't just mean the police and the judges because they're all still human and their opinion is just as, my opinion is just as valid as theirs, right? Unless something beyond all of us says that killing is wrong, then don't try to sell me on the killing thing. If I think it's okay, it's okay. And you can't do a thing about it. You follow me? So there is no right and wrong. There is no good and evil. There is no sin. If you take the one who defined it in the first place out of the equation, that's an amazing thing. If you really think about that, then it causes us to truly understand sin in the first place. And then we recognize our own nature, we recognize our own tendency, we recognize the horrificness, that's not even a word probably, but of our sin before God, because He is so holy and He defined it in the first place. So it's important to understand, you know, even our own sin in the light of the person of God, which is why we started with Him in the first place in this course. But we see that sin affects the whole of man's being. Every single part of us and of our nature and of our being is affected by sin. We see that sin has specific consequences, beginning with Adam and Eve. That was, first of all, their banishment from God's blessings and provision. They were kicked out of the garden, okay? Their loss of intimate fellowship with God, bearing the results of God's curse. God cursed the ground. They had to work the soil amidst thorns. God caused the childbirth to be painful. There is every reason to believe that somehow, women, you would have been able to bear children without pain. Because there would have been no such thing as pain. Right? Such thing as anything negative, evil, or wrong in any way. No such thing as emotional hurt. You know? No such thing as any kind of wrong or sin. So it's like, the curse of God was that every time you have a child and you bring another sinful creature into this world, you will remember and know that this pain is here because you need me. You desperately need me. Isn't that amazing? Now, ladies, those of you who have kids, it's worth it, right? Why is it worth it? Say, what was that, Karen?
Well, just the love you feel for them after they're born.
Okay. Is it about you, though? Is it about what you feel?
No.
Why is it worth it? Just go beyond that. Take that another step further. Why is it worth it?
You're accepting what God gave you.
Okay. Yep.
It also produce another potential virgin.
Because of who they are and have the potential to become, right?
Mm-hmm.
They are a life that God has made. And you have been able to be something that God uses to bring that life into existence. Their life is what makes it worth it. Their life. Not you, how much you love them, how much you have warm feelings for them, how much you, whatever. That's all true. But it's about, it's their potential and their life that makes that process worth it. So, the reminder is that the pain is there because we desperately need Him, and also because God is showing you that through that, He can still bring life. Right? Through that which caused wrong and evil and pain, God can still bring all this life. Right?
That whole thought
might
be easier to see when you have grandchildren.
Yes, grandchildren, a wonderful gift. Oh, I love you, here you go, give you back. That's awesome, isn't that great? All right.
Pastor Tim.
Yes.
As far as I know, and this is my potentially limited Bible understanding. They did not have children in the garden, right? The children
right.
were born afterwards.
After the fall, yes.
Do you think childbirth was instated because we were now degrading and life would have to continue? Do you think Adam and Eve
no.
in the garden?
No, because his command to them to be fruitful and multiply was
okay.
before that.
Okay.
Yeah, he told them to be fruitful and multiply. We know they must have sinned pretty quickly. Again, you know what, Mark? Let me even go as far as to say, I'm pretty sure that the order that is really, like, it's just like the actual order in which the events are listed in Genesis would suggest that they didn't have kids until after the fall.
Okay.
So that would even suggest that it may not have been a long time between creation and the fall. Because how long would they go before having kids? Before fulfilling the command of God, right? I mean, if God said, be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, populate, go for it. Wouldn't you? Am I the only carnal, like, seriously? Come on. I would. I'd be going, let's start today. You know what I mean?
Twice,
or whatever. It's like, let's, okay, God, you are awesome. You have great ideas. I'm all for that, okay? Seriously, that's not a sinful thing. That's a human natural thing that God put in them, the desire for one another, and the desire to be together, and to procreate, okay, and to be fruitful and multiply. So they... We're probably trying to figure it out.
Let's
Oh, look what happens. Okay, I don't get that. Okay. Okay. God, is there a manual?
It's
like, and God, yeah, amen. And God's like, there's no such thing as writing yet, so figure it out. The point is that in this whole new world of discovery and whatever, we have no idea what it was like. The point in all of that is that we see that they had all the potential to fulfill God's command to fill the earth without the curse. In fact, it would have been amazing without the curse, really. So there wouldn't have been such thing as pain and, you know, hurt and all those things, right? So again, that's a mystery, right? So the last thing I will say about this, let me see here. Is that it? Change of perspective. Their eyes open to no good and evil. Struggle, disorder, degeneration, and death. Remember, all those things, wrong perspective, the curse of God, struggle, disorder, degeneration, and death. Please remember, all of those things are here only because of sin. Now, that doesn't mean this. You try to be really, 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 really good and never sin, and you will not struggle or have any disorder or degeneration or death.
Wrong.
You can't get away from it, okay? We are caught in it for good, right? So let's just quickly finish this up. We are guilty of sin for three reasons. Number one, because of Adam's sin. I don't have, there's tons of scripture on that one, but there's a really, really good part of one of Paul's letters where he is talking, it's in Romans, where he's talking about how there's this sin nature that's been passed to us. Romans all the way from chapter really 4 or 5 all the way through to like 8 and 9, there's this amazing theological treatise almost on, you know, all of this stuff and what Christ has done. And remember, because of Adam's sin, we're guilty. Secondly, we have a sinful nature in us. That's number 2. And thirdly, because we have committed sin. So we are guilty because we inherited it, because we have the nature in us now, and because we act on it. Those all work together. Is there such a thing? Now let me ask you this. Do you have to sin? Do you have to? Do you have a choice? Do you have a choice not to? Do you?
Yes.
Okay, so that means you never have to, right? Is there such a thing as a human being who hasn't? Isn't that amazing? Don't you think there'd be one? Like, don't you think there'd just be someone who would go, yeah, unlike everybody else, I didn't have to, therefore I didn't. ever, right? I mean, wouldn't the odds be that there'd be one in billions and billions and billions? But it's because of number two that number three happens, right? And that there's no such thing as a person who has never committed sin. It's because it's in our nature. You still don't have the right to say, I have to, but it's in your nature to. You know what I mean? Your dog, doesn't have to pant. You know when the dog's panting? And it's basically doing that to cool, right? To cool itself. It doesn't have to, but it does, and it will continue to do so because it's in its nature to do so. Could the dog choose to shut its mouth and stop spreading its bad breath all over the house? Yes, but it won't. You get me? Okay?
Yeah.
So, now, how does this affect us? Let's take a look at it. That was a really dumb illustration. How does it affect us? What effect does it have on us? All right? Well, first of all, on our relationship with God. Sin makes man hate God. It really does. It's the reason that we would ever rebel against God or not want him in our lives or hate the concept of God. Secondly, God hates sin. So, we hate him because of it, and he hates it in us. Aren't you glad he doesn't hate us? Thirdly, sin breaks man's relationship with God. Isaiah 59:2, amazing scripture. Your iniquities have separated you from your God so that he will not hear you. He will not listen apart from you coming to Christ. Number four, sin brings guilt, which is a state rather than a feeling. Remember, you are not guilty because you feel guilty. You are guilty because you are guilty whether you feel guilty or not. It has nothing to do with your feeling. So if you have committed sin before God, you are guilty. You are also guilty before you sinned. Because you inherited your guilt. When you sin, you just complete the picture. You just seal the deal. You just make yourself guilty in every way. There is a sense of your guilt that you inherited. There's another sense of your guilt that you took on yourself when you chose to sin, when I chose to sin. So sin makes man liable for punishment. Remember, what is the wages of sin?
Death.
God is the one who said, when you sin, you shall surely die. He said that to who? Adam and Eve. In other words, you can't say God forgot to tell us and then told us halfway through history. He started by telling us that. He went, oh, by the way, see that tree over there? Don't eat of it. For the day in which you do, you will surely die. Now, did Adam and Eve die physically the same day that they partook of the fruit? No. So, what does that mean? Something died spiritually and relationally with God, right? Something was lost. They were thrown out, cast out of fellowship with him. What else happened?
They were kicked out of the garden.
Kicked out of the garden, but what else happened? Remember, the word that God used is, you shall surely die.
So the degeneration
physically
started.
The clock started ticking, right? All of a sudden, you ever watch The Lord of the Rings? I choose a mortal life. Remember, what was her name again? Arwen?
Yeah.
Eowyn? Eowyn?
No, Arwen.
Arwen. Arwen, says to, what's his name again?
Aragorn.
No, I choose a mortal life. Which only Liv Tyler could do really dramatically, you know what I mean? No, I choose. What she's saying is, I lay down immortality, because she was an elf, and they were immortal. If you ever see Lord of the Rings, you gotta watch it. It's awesome, phenomenal, imagery and stuff. But think about this. Suddenly, in an instant of time, Adam and Eve threw away immortality for mortality. Is that incredible?
I think, too, it's because they did not, much like our nature, they did not understand the consequences of their sin. Like, to them, they said, you surely will die. what's dying, right?
Yeah.
And then...
Well, no, I would say that yes and no to what you're saying in this, okay? Did they really know what they were getting into experientially? No. They have to experience it to really know it in the true sense of the word. But could there be any sense in which they could say, well, I didn't really know that would happen? No. Because remember, we are talking about people who are not only phenomenally smart and intelligent, but who also have absolute spiritual acuteness and awareness in every way. And when God says to them, when you eat that fruit, you will die. It's like he is speaking words that they go, and they have full understanding that that's the opposite of what we have now. Right now we have life forever. Death would not be a good thing. Whatever that means, it's the opposite of what we have now, and it is everything gone. So in a sense, I believe that they had full understanding, in a sense, not experientially, but potentially. And when they decided to go against that, it was because, remember, they doubted and disbelieved God's words. Remember, what does Jesus say over and over and over again? Why do you not believe? You are of such little faith? Come on here, right? He rebukes his disciples for having such little faith and for disbelieving. Same thing that happened in the garden. God rebuked them because they didn't believe. Did I not say, he says. He shows up in the garden. Hello, where are you guys? What's going on? Oh, we hid because we were naked. Really? Who told you that you were naked? You know what I mean? And it's like God has this dialogue with them, sort of patronize them, really. I mean, as if God didn't know, right? You know? He did know, but he's asking them so they could answer him, so they could answer to him and give an answer to him. And they say, well, here's what happened. They give the account. The reality is at that moment, it was sort of like God was showing them that what I told you, you can be certain will come true in every sense of the word. Now you will experience that my word is always true, no matter what. So you should believe. You should believe God's word. And isn't that the same for us? When we say, oh yeah, but I didn't really know what I was getting into. You should believe. You should trust God. He knows what he's doing. He can save you from a lot of crap if you trust him. It doesn't mean he's not going to let you go through crap. Oh, he'll let you go through stuff. But some of the stuff we go through is because we're stupid. Really. It's because we don't listen to him. It's we don't trust him. We don't follow his plan and his lead for our lives. And we go, oh, and it's the same thing that Adam and Eve did. We keep doing it. You know, so many years later.
Death is a consequence. Usually, we look at the consequences of doing something as being fairly immediate. Mm.
Yeah.
Death didn't come right away. So Satan tempted them, no, you won't die. In meaning, you won't die as soon as you eat it.
Right away, yeah.
But what happens is it comes a lot later on, right?
That's a good point, that the consequence wasn't immediate, and yet it was still a consequence,
yeah.
Right? A very real consequence. They lived a long, full... I mean, it's funny, and you think, oh, they lived for 930 years. Yeah, I trained them anytime. You know what I mean? But that's only because our entire frame of reference is... that living a good full life here on earth of, let's say, 80 years or 90 years would be like, wow, and amazing and wonderful. But compared to living forever, that's not very long.
Without aging.
Without aging.
To add to that as well, you can look at human nature as well. Who's afraid of death? Lots of people are afraid of death because it's something to look forward to. Or not to look forward to.
Yeah, I know what you mean. Yeah.
But if you're looking forward to it and you know what's coming, the fear of God or the fear of what's going to happen eventually, that's what I think is more kind of what you get out of it.
Well, remember, there was no such thing as fear.
Yeah.
I mean, they would have nothing to fear.
So the length of time doesn't really matter.
It's irrelevant. You're right. It's like you're going to die. It doesn't really matter when. It's coming.
We all know that.
And that's what the whole worst thing was, is that they're like God saying, you will surely die. It's not even when, it's not even how long it'll take. The point is, there was no such thing as death before. and now there is. It's inevitable.
It's the wait till your father gets home.
Wait till your father gets home. Doesn't matter when he's coming. Dread, right? You know how long it is?
We're talking about what God says is true and the consequences will come even if it's not right away. But the same thing is true in the positive. That
yes.
God's word is true and he tells us to persevere because the reward will come.
Absolutely. God's word is true no matter what that means. So if you love him with all your heart, your soul, and your mind, and your strength, is it possible you'll still have some problems? Is it possible you'll still go through some stuff? But will any of those things come as a result of you walking and living in disobedience? No. You follow me? If you walk in obedience to God and you love him in every way and you follow after him, I don't mean you'll never sin. What my point is if you are sowing in the right field, if you are investing the right kind of seed, will you then reap the fruit of God's blessing and provision and covering in your life? Even if that means you still go through crap. Yes, you will. All right? And God has instituted that his promises are yes and amen and sure. And what he says will come to pass. And there's so many scriptures we talk about. If you seek first the kingdom and righteousness, what? All these other things that you are always running after will be given to you. God knows your need. He'll bless you. He will cover that, right? That's a promise that's just as true as the wages of sin is death, okay? Just as true, right? All right, let's finish up here. And this is all we're going to have time for today is just this. So now we just added another week to our series. If I would just shut up, eh? You know, I don't know if you're thinking that, but I am. What we'll do is we'll see if we can tighten up some of the other weeks in the future and still keep it to 12. I want to really try to do that if I can, okay? But, yeah. Oh, Kyla.
What was number 5? Sin produces eternal...
We didn't cover that one yet. But sin does produce eternal separation from God. And now, you know, think about that for a second. If the wages, Romans 6, verse 23, if the wages or the payment of sin is death, so God says, you owe me, and there's only one way to pay. With all you have, your life in exchange, okay? So that I am recompensed for your sin. If the wages of sin is death, then apart from Christ, it must be final. It must be forever. There is no such thing as, okay, the wages of sin is death, now you'll die. Okay, I wait, okay, let's wait a little longer. Okay, now you don't have to die anymore. Now you don't have to be separated from me anymore. That's not full payment. Full payment has to be forever. That's why the payment of Christ is not only complete and total and full, but it was for forever. And you are purchased. What does the next verse say? Romans 6:24. The wages of sin is death. Or actually, it's the last part of the verse 23. Wages of sin is death, but
the
gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. That is forever, too. You know what I mean? Kyla.
So does that mean that everyone... like Adam and Eve and everyone in the Old Testament is in hell?
No. It doesn't mean that. when they died in the Old Testament, Hebrews chapter 11 is a really good chapter to read when it comes to coming to grips with how God regarded, and there's another scripture too, it's Hebrews 11. There's other scriptures too, but Hebrews 11 is the main one. Hebrews 11 is called the chapter of faith, okay? Where the writer of Hebrews, we don't know who it is. The writer of Hebrews is talking about all of these different characters in the Old Testament who lived lives by faith. And he even uses the term Abraham believed, and it was credited to him as righteousness. So he was saying, because he believed God in the light of ridiculous circumstances, you're 100 years old and you're going to have not only a child, but you're going to give birth to a nation of millions and millions and millions that will populate the earth like the sand on the seashore. That's a lot of faith. to believe that that could happen, right? So Abraham believes God, and it's credited to him as righteousness. And that chapter lays out how all of these heroes of faith, who were just normal people like you and I, simply believed God. And because of that, they were deemed what? Righteous. What does God require in order to be saved?
Righteousness.
He asks for us to have his righteousness. Now, can we possibly be righteous without Christ? Can we? Can we possibly be righteous without Christ?
How could David have been a man after God's heart without having some type of redeeming factor about him?
Did David have redemption? Why? What was it that brought redemption and righteousness to David?
He chose God.
Why?
Because he cried out and asked for forgiveness.
Why did he?
Because he sinned.
Why did he? Why did David ever run after God at all? Why?
Hmm?
It's just because he was a really cool guy who happened to make the right choice at the right time when everybody else didn't? Why?
Just give us the answer.
I would think it's the same reason as us, that even our faith is a gift for God's grace.
The scripture says that faith is something that God gives us through his grace. David was a man after God's own heart because he responded to the faith God gave him to believe. No matter what. And he was called righteous because of that. Before Christ, what is it saying here? But again, you got to read Hebrews 11, I'm telling you. Hebrews 11 says that all of them experienced this without having seen the promise fulfilled yet. They were all looking forward to what was to come, and that was Christ. They had not yet seen it, but they were eagerly anticipating and awaiting the promise of God. So without even knowing Jesus, they were able to experience salvation because God would send his son, complete salvation, and their salvation would then be complete because they were before him. And what did Jesus do when he died? He descended into the lower parts of the earth, otherwise known as Sheol, which is the place of the dead or the place of the departed, which is where all these people would be. And it says that he preached. He did a sermon. Jesus was a preacher. He preached to the captives. What were they captive to?
Death.
Which was separation, right? From God. Separation from life. Separation from what we are. Remember that whole Hebrew thought that once you die, you're separated from your body, you're no longer a complete person. So they're awaiting resurrection. They're all in Sheol, the place of the departed, awaiting something, awaiting Christ. God sends Jesus. He dies. He descends in the lower parts of the earth. He preaches to all those who are captive to death. And what does he do with them? It says that he led them in his train. The word train is like following him. Where? Into the presence of God. They're no longer there. They are now with God. Why are they there? Why are they redeemed? Why are they now where we will be when we die in Christ? Why?
Because they've seen Jesus' faith.
The promise.
Yes, yes and yes. Yes, yes and yes. Because of the promise of God that if they have faith, they will see Christ. And when he appeared to them, it's you! We've been waiting for you! And he goes, yeah, I just want to tell you, I'm the one you've been waiting for. I'm God the Son. I came as a man. I walked this earth. I just gave my life for all the humanity. You know, everybody who's ever sinned and ever lived, that's all you guys. And everybody who's ever going to live and sin, you know, that's billions of people coming. And by the way, let's just have an altar call. Let's just bow our heads. I want to, you know, see, raise your hand. If you, anyone wants to believe in me, just put your hand up. All the hands go up. Okay? He has the biggest altar call in all of history. And millions and millions and millions of people go, yep, we're with you. And then he goes, let's go to heaven. to the presence of the Father, to the throne room of God, and all of a sudden it is populated with millions of people who have never been there before, but they all eagerly awaited the promise, which was to come. What were you going to ask? Okay. So it's a mystery. There's a lot that we don't understand, but we do know what the scripture says, that they all, without being able to see what would happen, exercised their faith to believe that God's word was true, what he promised them would happen, and as a result, they were deemed righteous by God. And that's all he asked for at that point, until he would reveal Christ to them in Sheol, and they would say yes, and they all were redeemed fully, just as we are redeemed, because now they've placed their faith in Christ, just like we have.
Just a quick question. So would they not have had the Holy Spirit then?
What do you mean by that?
Well, Jesus is the Holy Spirit, right?
No. Take a look at lesson number one. Okay. Remember lesson number one? Okay, let's just back up.
The pretty picture.
Just review. Remember the pretty picture of the three? All right. Jesus is God. The Holy Spirit is God. The Father is God. But Jesus is not the Father. Jesus is not the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is not God or the Father. Okay? Jesus is the Son. He is not the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit.
Because Pentecost, and Jesus says he would send the Counselor, his Spirit.
Yes.
Right?
Yes. Jesus did not come back.
No, but his Holy Spirit did.
His Holy Spirit did. Yes.
So.
And that is the difference, is that the Holy Spirit is the third person of the Trinity, not the second. Mystery.
Oh, okay.
Mystery. It's a mystery. I don't really fully get that. Karen, here's another thing that even further confused all of us. And that is that the Holy Spirit is not just the Holy Spirit of God. He is also the Spirit of Christ. So in a sense, Jesus did come back. In a sense. But not in the same way. Not in the same way. Okay? Is Jesus physically, think about this, physically in his glorified body in heaven? Is he physically in heaven?
Do we know?
Yes. Well, yes.
What does the Bible say?
The Bible says right hand of God. He is at the Father's right hand, and he is what's the word?
Order.
No, but he stands there before God, interceding on our behalf.
And it also says that he bears eternally in his body the marks of his death. Right? In his side, his hands, and his feet. Forever. He has retained his humanness. Now, think about this. You can go, oh, well, how can you do that as a human? Hold on a minute. After the resurrection, what happened when the disciples were locked in a room? He just went and materialized in the room. Jesus is in a body that can do this stuff. That's what you and I get someday. Huh? Huh? Does that not wet your whistle? Would you like to do that? That would be cool. Think about it. They're in a room. Doors are locked. All of a sudden, it says Jesus appeared before them. And they freaked. Whoa, guys, it's me. Look. A second ago, he wasn't there. There's space. Now he's physical. Molecules, atoms, flesh. And he goes, give me something to eat. Give me a piece of fish. And he eats it in front of them and says, I'm like you, but glorified. And the difference is that body can stand before God and be in the throne of heaven. So the saints who have gone before us are awaiting that resurrection. We are awaiting that resurrection, and someday when we are raised in Christ at the final resurrection, or at the resurrection of the believers, which is not the final resurrection, the final one is the ones of those who don't know Christ, but it's like we will be like him, the scripture says, because we will see him as he is. Think about that. We'll be like him. Glorified bodies, which are designed to what? Live forever. Glorified bodies are designed just like Adam's was, to live forever, to never die, to never sin, to never do anything. All right? Remember, Adam was the first man. Jesus was called the second Adam, or the final. All right? And so we are then like him. We take on that nature. Yeah, Helen?
Well,
Your explanation to Kyla's question about how the people from the Old Testament that had Jesus yet, when you say that he went down and preached that sermon and gave them all a chance to follow him, then later you referred to the saints. Did he preach it to everybody, though? Did everybody get a chance?
Everybody no, only that? Those who were righteous. Only righteous those who had faith.
So,
only those who had faith. People who died godless, without faith, before Christ? No.
So it's faith that makes them righteous.
Yeah. Before Christ. And it still is true. That's the most amazing thing of the mystery between the Old and New Testaments. Is it different because of Jesus? Yes. Okay. It is different. But it has similarities. And that's what the whole point of Hebrews is that it's because of their faith that they were considered righteous. And it is the same with us. It is because we exercise our faith in Christ that God gives us what? The righteousness of Christ. Get it? It's His righteousness that becomes ours. So in a sense, those who were before Christ were given the righteousness of Christ before He ever came. You get it? They were clothed with His righteousness before they even knew what it was because of their faith. And their faith was looking forward to what would happen. Our faith does do that, but it's also placed in that which has already happened. Jesus came 2,000 years ago. You need to believe that He's the Son of God, that He died and rose again for you. That's past. You place your faith in that, and then you look forward in faith to what is going to happen. All they had to go on was that God said this, I better exercise my faith in yet what to come. They had nothing else to go on but that. Think about this. How much faith does it take to do that? Wow. We got it pretty good, don't we? We have all this stuff that God has done and said. He sent His Son. We can place our faith in Him and then follow Him on the rest of our lives. They had nothing to go on except God said, do this. Okay, I'll believe that you're going to raise up a nation for me, a 100-year-old guy. And the list goes on and on in Hebrews chapter 11, right? Let's just finish this up quickly because we need last two things. Human personality, right? Sin enslaves man. Sin clouds man's mind from reality and blinds him from the truth. Sin has a tendency to cause the sinner to deny his sin. Think about that tendency. Is that not true? When I sin, it wasn't really that bad. You know what I mean? And relationship. Sin dislocates and destroys man's relationship with other humans. And sin negatively affects man's relationship with his environment, nature. Either we become a slave to it or we destroy it. Why is it that in sin, we either say, yeah, forget it, you know, I'll do whatever I want and destroy the planet, or we worship and hug the trees? That's what sin does. They're both sinful. Nature is not worthy of your worship. Nature is worthy of your stewardship. And that's where the balance lies, right? Thanks, everybody.